Success is not final. And failure is not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. Success is not final. And failure is not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. Those words were spoken by one of the most famous figures of the 20th century, a somewhat cantankerous prime minister by the name of Winston Churchill. As a young man, Churchill had been in the British government service, and during the First World War, he had championed and promoted a military campaign, an effort to open a second front against the German enemy in Turkey. And he promoted an invasion attempt at a place called Gallipoli. It was a disaster. The Allied forces lost the element of surprise almost immediately. The troops were trapped on the beach. It was bad, a failure. And he was disgraced. But he continued in government service and became known as a somewhat quirky yet powerful speaker. And then the Second World War started. And one by one, the Allied countries fell before the German panzer divisions, the Belgians and the Dutch and the Danes and the Poles and even the French forts, the massive forts along the Maginot Line, were simply bypassed by the panzer divisions. And Britain found itself almost alone, standing against the might of the Nazis and fearing an invasion. The British Prime Minister was forced out. The opposition said the only candidate that they would support to be Prime Minister was Winston Churchill, probably because they thought he would fail. And yet his oratorical ability, his words, his ability to speak was just what the people needed. And he gave that very famous speech. You've probably heard parts of it. We'll fight them on the beaches. We'll fight them on the fields. We'll fight them in the streets. We will never surrender. If the British Empire lasts 1,000 years, they will say that this was our finest hour. And he marshaled the British people, and of course, eventually, was on the winning side. Man of the hour. And not long after that, they voted him out of office. He was no longer prime minister. What Winston Churchill said was, success is not final, and failure is not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. And that's the lesson that God was trying and is going today to teach to his prophet. The prophet from Tishbe, the Tishbite, we call him Elijah. We talked about him last week, his success. He stood up almost alone against the gods of the land, 450 prophets of Baal, 400 prophets of the Asherah. The king of the northern kingdom built a temple to Baal in Samaria. His queen Jezebel, even more feared, and rightly so, she subsidized those 450 prophets of Baal and 400 prophets of the Asherah. They, as the Old Testament writer said, they ate at her table. Now that doesn't mean she had 850 people at her table every day, but she subsidized. And she was an enemy to the gods, the God of Abraham and Isaac and Jacob and his prophets. And God had to hide his prophet Elijah for a time. But finally, he came forward. There had been a drought in the land for 3.5 years at his word, and he provoked a crisis at Mount Carmel. He said, you can go first to the prophets of Baal, put a sacrifice out, and see if your so-called God will answer. And he did not, for he was a false god. And then Elijah prayed, let the people see, God. Let them know that I'm your prophet and I speak your word. And at his prayer, fire fell from heaven. The people, understandably, not surprisingly, fell down and shouted, the Lord, he is God, which is really what the name Elijah means, the Lord is God. And a national sort of revival took place. And he was the man of the hour until something else happened. And out of this experience, God's going to teach him that it is the courage to continue that really matters. Turn with me once again in 1 Kings chapter 19, and let's read the verses that lead up to those that we had read a few moments ago. From 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning to read in verse 1. This is what happened after the great victory at Mount Carmel. 1 Kings chapter 19, beginning to read in verse 1. And Ahab, the king, told Jezebel, his queen, all that Elijah had done and how he had killed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah, saying, so may the gods do to me and even more, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. She sent her messenger to say, in 24 hours, you're a dead man. And she did this stuff. And he was afraid, Elijah. And he arose and ran for his life and came to Beersheba, which belongs to Judah, and left his servant there. But he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a juniper tree, and he requested for himself that he might die. And said, it is enough now, O Lord, take my life, for I am not better than my fathers. He lay down and slept under a juniper tree, and behold, there was an angel touching him. And the angel said to him, arise, eat. Then he looked, and behold, there was at his head a bread cake baked on hot stones and a jar of water. So he ate and drank, and lay down again. The angel of the Lord came again a second time and touched him and said, arise, eat, because the journey is too great for you. So he arose and ate and drank and went in the strength of that food 40 days and 40 nights to Horeb, the mountain of God. And that's where the experience we read about earlier took place. After the great victory, it appeared, at Mount Carmel. The drought broke. He told King Ahab, you better get in your chariot and start back to Jezreel. The rain's coming. And the rain caught Ahab along the way. Elijah, filled with the Spirit of God and victory, began to run, and he outran the king and the king's chariot back to Jezreel. But when Ahab got home, he went and talked to Jezebel. Now, Ahab tended to pout. You'll read in a later story about a land deal that fell through for him. And he went and he lay down on his bed, turned his face to the wall, and would not eat. And he told his wife Jezebel about what had happened. She said, I'll take care of it. And she did. His opponent Naboth ended up dead, and the land ended up in Ahab's hand. Jezebel was a dangerous lady. Now, Ahab would pout. Jezebel got even. And she sent a message to Elijah. He's the man of the year. Everybody's patting him on the back. You're the great prophet of God. We're with you, Elijah. You know, this is terrific. We got it. And Elijah gets this messenger, And he says, Jezebel says, in 24 hours, you're going to be just as dead as those prophets of Baal and the Asherah. And this was no idle threat. And as far as we can tell from the biblical record, all those people that were patting Elijah on the back disappeared. Nobody, as far as we can tell, stood up with him. Only his servant remained with him. And Elijah panicked. And he ran. Sometimes in our lives, we have to choose between flight and fulfillment. It's the way Warren Wiersbe says it. And he chose flight. You know that story when Jesus was in the Garden of Gethsemane and they came to arrest him, and Peter pulled out the sword, cut off the ear of the high priest's servant, and would have fought. Peter would have stood there and fought all night now. But Jesus said, no. The scriptures must be what? They must be fulfilled. Jesus chose fulfillment over flight. And there will be days in our lives in which we have to make a choice between flight and fulfillment. If you can, choose fulfillment. Elijah chose flight. But God didn't give up on him. He took off running. He ran from Jezreel area, evidently, going south past Samaria and past Gilgal and past Jerusalem and past Bethel all the way to Beersheba. Beersheba was the Hebrew town all the way to the southern tip of Israel. Beyond it was the wilderness of Sinai that the people had crossed with Moses. He got to Beersheba. At this point, he had traveled about 100 miles. And as far as we know, other than his servant, nobody went with him. And he left his servant in Beersheba, and he ran a day's journey out into the wilderness, sat down under a juniper tree, and he gave up. If you've ever been under a juniper tree in your life, well, you know how he felt. He felt abandoned and betrayed. And he said, just let me die, God. Just let me die. I thought we had made progress. I thought we had made great spiritual progress, but everybody just disappeared. I am no better than my fathers. We haven't accomplished anything. Just let me die. And he fell asleep, exhausted, alone. He woke up, an angel touched him and said, eat. And there was a bread cake and a jar of water. And he ate, fell back asleep again. The angel woke him a second time. There was a bread cake and a jar of water. Eat, because the journey is too great for you. And he ate, and he traveled all the way from Beersheba to Horeb, the mountain of God. This is the mountain where Moses had seen the burning bush when God sent him back to Egypt. And most Old Testament scholars believe it is also called the same mountain Sinai, because God had said to Moses, you will know that I have sent you when I bring you back and you serve me on this mountain. And Moses went up in Sinai to get the Ten Commandments. This is probably the same mountain. The distance from Beersheba to Mount Sinai, Mount Horeb, is 200 miles. He had traveled 300 miles. He was not going back. And he crawled into a cave, and it says he was lodging. That means he was living in a cave. I'm done. Finished. But he needed to learn that while success is not final, failure is not fatal. God wasn't done with his prophet. God even helped him run. He fed him twice. God doesn't just care about great events and great movements. God cares about you. God cared about his prophet. And he had to fix his prophet before he could do more things through his prophet. And God has time to get you fixed. He has time to get me fixed. All of us fixed. And he cares about you. Not just great movements. He cares about you. And a voice came to Elijah. Now here he is out in this cave, living in a cave, feeling abandoned and betrayed and forgotten. And what does the voice say? What are you doing out here, Elijah? Did I call you to preach to the rocks and the snakes and the lizards? What are you doing out here? Well, Elijah was fed up. How did he answer? God, I have been very zealous for the Lord, the God of hosts, but the children of Israel, they've broken your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I'm the only one left. And they're come to kill me now. He was done. And the voice said, go out and stand at the edge of the cave. And then it says a very simple little verse, but profound little verse. And the Lord was passing by. The Lord came to the wilderness of Sinai for his prophet. And he'll go wherever he has to go for you. And a great wind, it says it broke the rocks. Now that's quite a wind. A great wind came, but God wasn't in the wind. And a great earthquake took place. God wasn't in the earthquake. Great fire. God wasn't in the fire. And then, depending on your translation, a still, small voice. Or a gentle blowing. God whispered. See, God whispers a lot. Every teacher knows that if you need to get your students' attention, sometimes what you need to do is while you're speaking, gradually let your volume get less and less and speak more and more, pronounce more and more distinctly until you're just whispering and they have to really concentrate to hear what you're having to say. God whispers because we really have to concentrate to hear him that way. We want him to scream. But God whispers. He whispers in your heart. And God whispered. He felt rejected. But God began his restoration. God whispered. And what did he say? This is the best part of the story. Same thing he said before. What are you doing here, Elijah? God's going to keep saying what you need to hear until you listen. Because that's what we need, and he loves us. When I was teaching, my students occasionally would say, we've covered that. Some of you are teachers, you've heard this. We've covered that. I would ask them, did you learn that? Our purpose was not to cover it, but that you learn it. And until we learn it and do it, God's just going to keep saying it, whispering it over and over again. Carrie just finished Jonah. God said to Jonah, go to Nineveh, preach to those people. They were a hated people, and Jonah didn't like them. And so he tried to run away, just like Elijah. And when God finally got him stopped and the big fish spit him up on the land, what did God say to him? Same thing. Go to Nineveh. Preach to those people. God's going to keep saying it until you hear it. Every parent understands this. He's going to keep saying it. So he heard the same question. What did he give God? Same answer. God was persistent, but Elijah was stubborn. I've been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, But the people of Israel have forsaken your altar, have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword. You're just not doing much, God. And I'm the only one left, and now they're going to kill me. You can tell God how you feel. You really can. He already knows. Get it out so that you can get it over it. Get it out. It's hard to get over it till you get it out. Get it out so that you can get over it. This was God's process. God is restoring his prophet. His prophet felt rejected. God is restoring his prophet because God cares about his prophet, just like he cares about you. What did God give him? God gave him the remedy. What was the remedy? God gave him a job. God gave him a task. He said, now go back to the wilderness of Damascus. The wilderness of Damascus was 300 miles or more north of where he was. Just go back where you were before. Go back to the wilderness of Damascus. I've got a job for you. You see, heaven is a great reward. We have every right to look forward to heaven as believers. But the work is the gift. Heaven is the reward. But the work is the gift. The gift God gives us is the task. Now, it may change over the years, but there's always going to be a task. It would be a terrible thing if God said to you, there's just nothing, you know, all the spots are filled. There's nothing valuable, nothing of value that for you to do. Just, you know, if, don't call me, I'll call you. He's not likely to say that. The work is the gift, your fulfillment and joy, peace. It's going to come in the work. Now, there's probably going to be some frustration, some disappointment, but the work is the gift. God gave him a job. Go back to the wilderness of Damascus. I want you to anoint Hazael to be the king over Aram. I've got a job for him. I want you to anoint Jehu, son of Nimshi, to be the king over Israel. He's eventually going to be Ahab's replacement. Ahab is not forever Elijah, nor is Jezebel. My way is going to stand. Go back and anoint him. He's going to be the king over Israel. And find Elisha, the son of Shaphat, from Abel-Meholah. He is going to be prophet after you. My work's going to go on, Elijah. There's going to have to be a prophet after you. Anoint him. Start getting him ready. This is your job. This is what I have for you to do. You are not abandoned. You are not forgotten. This is what you need to do for me. And he did it. He went back and he anointed Hazael and he anointed Jehu and he anointed Elijah or Elisha. God's going to keep saying it until we hear it. And he is remembered as one of the great prophets. Centuries later, Jesus would ask his apostles, what are people saying about me? They talk really nice when they talk to me, but what are you hearing? And they said, some of them think you're Elijah. Come back again. He was remembered as one of the great prophets because success is not final and failure is not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. That's the lesson. There was a man born in the United States about 200 years ago now. Born in Indiana, his father, a farmer, lost the farm and had to move his family to Kentucky. And not long after that, this young man's beloved mother died. His father left him and his younger sister alone to go into the city to find another wife. His younger sister died. The night before his wedding, his fiancée died of typhoid. He was so discouraged, people said, well, you don't like farming, try business. He tried three different businesses, and all three of them failed. He spent 17 years paying off the debts. Got even more depressed. He loved to read and to study. He began studying law. And he became a lawyer and began riding the circuit in Illinois. He was great at telling stories and became well known. People said, you ought to run for Congress, and he did. And he won once, but then he lost. He would eventually run in 10 elections. He would lose 7. He would lose 7 of the 10. But the second one was an election to be president of the United States. And by what can only be called a miraculous set of circumstances, Abraham Lincoln was elected president of the United States. Soon after, the nation fell into civil war. His son died. His wife fell into almost insanity for weeks. He just continued faithfully. America won the war, or the Union won the war. 6 days later, he was shot and killed. A man who was there when he died said, now he belongs to the ages. What Abraham Lincoln learned was the courage to continue. That success is not final and failure is not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. That's what God wants his people to have. If you're in the place that God has put you and you're doing what God has given you to do, then you should know, if you're fulfilling your task, then you should know that he is proud of you and pleased with you and smiles upon you because you are demonstrating the courage to continue. Isaiah wrote about it. He wrote to the Hebrew people of his day, speaking God's word. He said, why do you say, O Israel, and assert, O Jacob, my way is hid, and the justice due me is overlooked? And they didn't just say that. They weren't talking about their Babylonian captives or their enemies. What he really wrote was, my way is hid from the Lord, and the justice due me is overlooked by my God. And then as you approach the end of that great 40th chapter of Isaiah, he wrote, have you not heard? Do you not know that the everlasting God, the Lord, the maker of the heavens and the earth, does not grow weary? His wisdom is beyond our understanding. He gives strength to the weary, and to those who lack might, he increases power. Youths may get tired. Young men may stumble badly. But those who what? Who wait upon the Lord. Some of your translations will say those who hope in the Lord, because the Hebrew word there can mean wait or hope. We wait on things if we have hope. And if we're waiting, we're hoping. Those who wait upon the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk, and they will have the courage to continue. And that's the lesson that God's trying to... We will all have some successes, but they're not final. And we'll all have some failures, but they're not fatal. What matters is the courage to continue. And that's my message for you today, especially if you're God's child in Jesus Christ. What God wants to give us is the courage to continue, because that's what honors Him. Lauren is going to play for our offertory. I am satisfied with Jesus. He has done so much for me. He has suffered to redeem me. He has died to set me free. I am satisfied. I am satisfied. I am satisfied with Jesus. But the question comes to me as I think of Calvary, is my master satisfied with me? When my work on earth is ended and I cross the mystic sea, oh, that I could hear him saying, I am satisfied with thee. I am satisfied. I am satisfied. I am satisfied with Jesus. But the question comes to me as I think of Calvary, is my master satisfied with me? Is your master satisfied with you? That is our question today. Let's pray together. Lord, we thank you for this wonderful story and the way you speak to us through your servant. Whatever be before us, whether it appear to be a success or a failure, give us the courage to continue in your walk and in your way. If there are those who have never made a commitment to you, let it be known that they're going to walk in your way and seek to be born again by your Spirit and power. For only then can we hope to be what you would have us to be. If there are those here who have not done that, give them the courage today to step out for you, to let it be known that they're going to be a Jesus follower. Or those that need a church home, or those that need to renew their dedication before you, the altar is open. Give us the courage to continue. We pray in your precious name. Amen.